turn right. Take the bridge to your left.
Ethan, that is not me. Do you copy?
Turn right.
I definitely laughed really hard when they started smashing all their equipment, because the vast majority of AI models nowadays don't actually run on your device. My name is Sasha Luccioni, and I'm an AI researcher at Hugging Face, a global startup that works on responsible AI. My research is really around evaluating the ethical and environmental impacts of AI models. Today, we're going to be looking at AI scenes in movies and TV shows and judge how real they are.
You're obviously there.
At your service, sir.
Engage heads-up display.
Check.
Chatbots right now are more like, you know, Siri can set an alarm for you, or Alexa can add, I don't know, chocolate milk to your grocery list. But we are far, far from Jarvis. Sadly, that would be really great, though. I think the real challenge of that would be to take all these different sources of information. So Tony Stark's history and what he likes and his habits. And if you start integrating different sources of information, it's really hard to essentially weave them together, because currently AI is not very good at taking different sources of input and stitching it together and responding to it in real time.
So there are still terabytes of calculations needed before an actual flight is adjourned.
Jarvis, sometimes you gotta run before you can walk.
So the way it usually works now for AI and aviation, it's really responding to, for example, GPS coordinates, altitude, actually wind speeds and wind directions as well. You would have to pre-train the system, so just, you know, going out for a test flight like Tony Stark did would be pretty dangerous, because if there's no data about that location, if there's no like topology data of the city of Los Angeles, you can be in big trouble. Autopilots and planes use a lot of artificial intelligence, especially when they're cruising, especially, you know, when things are pretty stable.
There is a potentially fatal buildup of ice occurring.
If there's like really a life or death decision, like is the case here, ice buildup, we want to make sure that we're listening to the AI instead of just like YOLOing our way through the sky. Most of the AI that's used on planes is human in the loop. Human in the loop is a type of AI system where humans are really involved in the decision making, and it essentially makes sure that no particularly damaging or particularly high stakes decisions get made without a human getting involved in the process somehow. It's really important to have a human pilot call the shots, even when the sensors are freezing up. And that's why we always have, you know, two pilots in planes, because AI isn't really good with new situations it's never been trained with, so you always want to have someone to pick up, you know, in case of a mistake. I would give it a 4 because the elements are there, so we definitely have AI assistants, we definitely have AI autopilot, but it's not at the level of Iron Man. That's actually something that's done right now. I mean, every time you go through a toll booth, for example, in the United States or Canada, it will read your license plate. It could also like figure out what the make of your car is. And we've gotten really good at object recognition, especially in terms of like cars and street scenes, mostly because of autonomous vehicles. Estimating someone's height or like approximate weight is definitely something that people use AI for. Like I would say, like in like CCTV surveillance, like especially in, you know, if you're trying to identify someone like a perpetrator, this is something that AI is trained to do. Whether it does it super well will depend. Essentially, like for example, how, like if the person's wearing baggy clothing, whether you have objects around the person, if you're trying to figure out like how tall someone is, it's really hard if they're just like in a bare room where you have no objects that you can use to compare and to triangulate, especially. If a person's beside a car or like beside a pool table, then you can really say, well, it's probably like this height. It would be really hard for AI to do hand-to-hand combat in a way that's really like reactive. There's an element of trying to predict what someone will do and reacting quite quickly. And AI is typically not very good at predicting what people, because we're so unpredictable and we're so spontaneous. You know, as human beings, we do this almost subconsciously. Like if you're
if you had to, you know, throw something at someone who was running, you would tend to kind of throw it at where you think they would be in a second or two. But for an AI, they would have to like predict the trajectory of someone's movement and then grab them at that time. I would rate this clip an 8. This movie is definitely ahead of its time, and I think it actually came to shape a lot of the AI research that was done in the next decades.
Where am I going? Come on, come on.
Stand by, stand by.
I'm losing picture again.
Looking for another. The entity is knocking out satellites faster than I can hack into them.
So the villain in the recent Mission Impossible movie is a omniscient entity that's an AI algorithm that can hack satellites, that can predict human behavior, that can clone voices. AI can definitely knock out satellites if it's being used by a human. So it's kind of like a computer virus, right? Once you plant the virus, it can do all sorts of things. And actually, AI is being used in hacking. It's being used in kind of like cyber attacks. But it's not like, once again, the agency doesn't come from the AI. It comes from the person who's gonna choose the place to deploy it, or like the type of satellite to target.
Reggie, I don't see her. Where is she?
Down the narrow alley and turn left.
The voice cloning was spot on. That can definitely be done already right now. So essentially, how AI voice generation works is that if you have enough audio of someone talking, it will learn like the actual voice frequencies, the actual like audio frequencies of someone's voice and the way they talk. And in this case, it really seemed like it was taking words that Benji already said and just like shuffling them around or just playing them back without actually doing the modeling parts.
Ethan, our comms have been breached. You're talking to the entity.
Turn right. Take the bridge to your left.
Ethan, that is not me.
AI voice duplication has gotten so good. I remember we had a case late 2023 where someone imitated the voice of the mayor of London saying some like super racist remarks. People reached out to us saying like, can you verify if this is really the mayor of London speaking or someone spoofing his voice? And we were listening to those clips obsessively, and it's actually super, super hard to tell. And especially for a public figure like a mayor, there's enough of his voice data out there that you don't even need to like hack into anything. You can just use the clips that are out there, use his speeches. I definitely laughed really hard when they started smashing all their equipment, because the vast majority of AI models nowadays don't actually run on your device, on your laptop, on your phone. I give this clip a 3 because of the agency issue. So AI is only a tool, and it can be used for good, it could be used for bad, but by itself, it's not gonna wake up and start hacking satellites. Having so many drones in one spot and being able to like make them all function somehow together for me is really hard to believe, because I mean, currently drones usually work either like by themselves, kind of in high in the sky in terms of warfare, or you know, sometimes they will have synchronized drones, but more like the tiny little ones for like the firework type displays. But actually having like military drones in such close quarters and not like shooting at each other, I think it's a really big technical challenge.
Stand by for retinal and biometric scan. Shall I execute all cancellation protocols?
Do it! Execute them all!
Confirmed.
Tony Stark's glasses allow anyone using them to control the AI systems that he created. That includes the defense satellites and the combat drones that you see in this clip. You could use smart glasses to control drones if you were talking to your glasses, you know, with all the noise that it's in the clip. Like, you have to be really sure that, you know, that's what he said and that's the instruction that he gave, because there's always some amount of interference. I feel like tech companies have been trying to make smart glasses a thing for like the last decade, but currently they're so clunky and not particularly user-friendly. So, you know, once again, if you wanted someone to be able to control satellites or drones with them, like, they would need to be hooked up to your brain, and we do not have that level of connection between, you know, neural links and smart wearables right now. Like, we're not there yet. I would rate this clip like a 2 for realism.
If you knew the trouble I had getting an AI to read and duplicate facial expressions. So I turned on every microphone and camera across the entire planet.
Getting everyone's cell phone data would be a really hard hack to do. So I would hope that our data is better protected than that, let's say. But of course, like, I mean, you do hear of cases of microphones being switched on when someone's phone is on.
What's your favorite color?
Red.
Lie.
Then what is my favorite color?
I don't know.
So there are AIs that are purported to detect if people are lying and to detect their emotions. The only one I would trust to a certain extent would be things like lie detector tests, which already exist, but that really are based on heartbeats and how stressed people are getting, really in the physiological sense, like how stressed our body is becoming. But anything that's based on just video, for example, of someone talking into a camera, I really wouldn't trust that. For example, if it was trained on Caleb's data, it could tell that Caleb is lying, but it couldn't read his mind, essentially. In that case, you need like direct access to someone's brain. I would rate this a 4 because the whole consciousness aspect and the aspect of detecting a lie just based on, you know, like a single word answer is really hard to believe.
I've run a brothel for 10 years, and if there's one thing I know, it's when I'm being with.
Westworld is pretty realistic in terms of AI, and here they're using a dialogue tree, which isn't really used that much anymore. So you could like program chatbots to actually follow essentially like a decision tree based on, you know, inputs, but they're really brittle. Even back then, this was like IBM Watson days, like there were limitations, even like in specific cases of we were working on like chatbots when you lost your credit card, like they would break quite quickly. So they're already being phased out. And nowadays with the modern day chatbots that are based on large language models, they don't use this kind of like schematic, deterministic way of planning dialogue at all. They're actually based on probabilities and predicting next words. ChatGPT and other dialogue systems sound or look so realistic. It's because they're trained on essentially billions and billions of words. So it's kind of cute because it's like taking like an OG AI technique and using it in like a very forward-thinking, very futuristic context. AI can definitely improvise in the sense that it's no longer hard-coded like the dialogue tree that Maeve had. So it can improvise in the realm of what it was trained on. If you train an AI model on customer service logs and you have people losing their credit cards and, you know, asking where the nearest ATM is, like it will do fairly well even if you use words that weren't exactly the same ones as what it was trained on. But if you start asking it like, what is the meaning of life, they will answer things that make no sense, essentially. That's when you know that your system is malfunctioning. I think that the chances that AI drones will mess up are definitely too high for them to be used in warfare. If I was in charge, we wouldn't be using AI drones because I've seen the way AI technologies fail spectacularly. And also for me, using AI to actually like make the decision of who to kill is completely unacceptable from a moral and ethical perspective. Probably what the drone is doing is some form of facial recognition, which drones are able to do. Once again, like if the person's moving around, or also like I don't know how people didn't notice it because like it was obviously flying around. I feel like an AI sniper could do a good job from far away, but in like real time, right? Like detecting a target and shooting the target, but doing that kind of like reconnaissance with a drone and then following up with a sniper, like I feel that that's not very realistic. It's really hard for AI to predict the future in a meaningful way. So for example, once you have that drone that like mapped out where people were, say that they're moving around in that space. So for me, like the implausibility is like, how would the bullet or the missile go from where the drone saw the person to be 5 minutes ago to where the person is if they moved? But there's like some piece of the puzzle that's missing for me for those like two steps, first the reconnaissance and then the shooting to take place. The first part is very plausible in terms of technology. So dialogue trees are definitely a thing and were definitely used. But the second part of like the drone controlled bullets for me is just out of this realm, out of our galaxy, honestly. So I guess on an average, it would be a 6. Typically, we say swarm intelligence when it's multiple robots. It can be any kind of technology that will coordinate together and will be able to cover more ground or scan more items. And there's a branch of AI called planning. And so for example, if you have one robot, you know, you have to do all of the corners of a room or a building. But if you have multiple robots, then you can like use planning in order to dispatch them in the most optimal way possible so that you spend less time searching.
An ID. It's not him.
I think that Minority Report planted a grain in people, a seed in people's brain that you can predict crime. There are lots of people who are working on predictive policing, for example, and these systems get sold to precincts across the world as a way of actually, you know, anticipating crimes before they happen. Everything from robots to actual like allocations of police resources to certain areas because an AI model told them that that's where the crime was going to happen. And the percentage was like 1% accurate of like commercial predictive policing systems when they're applied in the real world. I would give this one a 7.
Keep walking. And stop. I figured you were hungry.
Her is definitely a projection of where I think a lot of people would want AI to be. And I think that's why maybe people love that movie so much. And actually, you know, it keeps coming back as an example of like an AI girlfriend or companion that's able to read emotions and anticipate needs, definitely in a way that's currently impossible. Like, especially, for example, like, oh, I figured you were hungry. I'm wondering how that kind of anticipation can be done, because even as a human, you know, I don't know if we're able to anticipate someone's hunger just by looking at them.
His name is Alan Watts. Do you know him? He was a philosopher. He died in the 1970s, and they input all of his writing and everything they ever knew about him into an OS and created an artificially hyper-intelligent version of him.
Very nice to meet you, Theodore.
That definitely sounds like something complex to do. Like, you could definitely make a limited version of someone who's passed away based on, for example, interviews with that person or writing from that person. So, for example, like Abraham Lincoln or Ruth Bader Ginsburg, but once again, it would be like a really limited representation of them. It would be like the legal text they wrote or like whatever the laws that they put forth, putting any kind of consent issues aside, but making any kind of like virtual clone of someone is never going to be like their full persona. It's always going to be like a little sliver of who they actually are. Scraping data from the internet, right, like is used for training all these AI language models, and to what extent that's ethical or you know, to what extent consent even is part of the picture for living people is still under debate. So I feel that for dead people is like a next level that we haven't even gotten to yet. I would rate this around a 5. So I think it's halfway there in terms of the capabilities, but of course they're jacked up.
We'd have to cut his higher brain functions without disturbing the purely automatic and regulatory systems.
Currently, the way that AI systems are made, you can't really distinguish between different functionalities. We can't really meaningfully know what part of an AI model is doing what thing. Its ability to generate poetry and not like answer questions, like that's all done under the same hood. There are applications of AI that try to do lip reading, especially for assistance more than surveillance. From what I've seen, you really need to be facing the camera. You need to be speaking relatively slowly. Anytime there's like a beard or a face mask, for example, then it's obviously impossible. And so I think that in this case, because they're speaking from the side, it would be really hard to use any of the techniques that we currently have for lip reading because you don't really see them speaking at the camera.
I'm afraid my mind is going.
The fact that at the end he's like unplugging the discs or whatever, like we don't do that anymore. I mean, I guess it's not implausible as much as very old fashioned. There's different levels of self-awareness when it comes to a machine or a computer. HAL can definitely be aware of its drives being unplugged, like the physical absence of a drive that was connected before that's being disconnected now. So that's definitely a form of awareness. It's a form of, you know, interpreting physical knowledge and acting upon that. But whether an AI will be able to associate like a disk being unplugged to death or not existing anymore, so that's really more like the metaphysical property that is a little bit less less clear to me. I would rate this clip like a 2 because we're not there yet in terms of lip reading, and we're definitely not there yet in terms of self-awareness. My favorite scene was the dialogue tree scene from Westworld because we see real AI techniques with the names as well, which was really rare in movies that you actually see something being done and then an explanation of what that exact technique is. If you enjoyed watching this video, why not click on the next one?